If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 21. We're going to get into the Word this morning. 1 Samuel 21. It's about to get more dramatic as the drama intensifies between King Saul and David. David is on the run. He's a fugitive. He's a man fleeing for his safety. And now is a good time to point out this detail. For the next 9 chapters, we will get a picture of David's wilderness experience, you could say. His wilderness experience. What do I mean by that? Well, as Israel's wilderness experience followed an exodus from a foreign king, Pharaoh, if you are familiar with the book of Exodus, so David's following an exodus from a king as well, King Saul. Israel's wilderness experience preceded possession of the promised land. Likewise, for David, it preceded the possession of a promised kingdom. David's experience parallels in many ways to the Israelites following their removal from Egypt. Israel, the Hebrews, they were being pursued by armed forces and chariots of the king as they were fleeing. They were fleeing for their lives. Israel was a very prosperous nation. They were considered as a threat. And this created fear in Pharaoh, just like Saul was fearful of David. In like manner, David is being pursued by Saul and his servants. Israel encountered many enemies along the way in the wilderness, just like David. And yet the Lord's protection was evident in both Israel's case and David's case. Connections like these, churches, it's not by accident. Absolutely not. These similarities between the two only magnify the story of David here for all of us. I mean, it really is a story of epic proportions. And in the end, the Lord will ultimately give David the fulfillment of all the good promises made to him. And so before we get into the Word this morning, we're going to be in 1 Samuel 21. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 9. I'm just going to ask, church, that you join me in a word of prayer before we get into our study together. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this morning. God, we thank you, Lord, for this time together that we have as a church to read and study your word. Lord, may you speak to us through your word. May we see with our eyes, God, on the importance of mercy and how you call us to be a merciful people. God, help us to eliminate maybe anything in our lives, any form of legalism, any attitudes of legalism. A mentality of legalism, we would cast it at your feet. Or that we would remove anything, Lord, that can hinder us, Lord, from loving you the way we should and loving others. And we see this in our passage this morning. God, be with us now, and we thank you for this time together. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. 1 Samuel 21, beginning in verse 1, this is the word of the Lord. It says this, David went to the priest Ahimelech at Nob. And we'll stop right there. We're going to pause. There are 5 observations that I want for us to examine in our text this morning, church. When studying God's word, it's always best to take our time, ask questions, take into account the scene, the people, the names of people and places. We can miss many details by simply reading over a portion, any portion of the Bible. So the first observation I want for us to discover found in this opening verse, David went to the priest Ahimelech at Nob, is this. Observation number 1. If you like to take notes, you can note this down. You can learn a lot about a person by seeing where they turn to in times of trouble. David is on the run. And now we have a new character introduced to us in our drama between King Saul and David, a priest by the name of Ahimelech. His name means my brother is king or brother of a king. And indeed, Ahimelech will act like a brother towards David. Ahimelech was the great grandson of Eli, You remember Eli and his two wicked sons. We've learned about Eli and his sons earlier on in this scroll, in this book. And he was a descendant of his. And David now turns to this priest for help. Now, Nob is a city between Jerusalem and Gibeah. It became the priestly city after the destruction of Shiloh. If you remember, the tabernacle was located in Shiloh, and here now it is in Nob. Nob means a high place, a city of priests. And if you've been with us from the beginning, studying 1 Samuel, I want to remind you and throw this detail in. I want to take you back to a scene in chapter 9 when Saul is with one of his father's servants as they're looking for their father's lost donkeys. And if you remember, after searching, they stumbled. They somehow happened to stumble in Samuel's area, the prophet, in the land of Zuph. And Saul's servant told him that they should go and meet with this man of God, who is Samuel, and basically ask for help, ask for guidance, right? Remember? Saul, however, is totally unaware of who Samuel was, even though he was well known all throughout Israel. Saul lacked spiritual perceptiveness. Now, not long ago, in our passage, when David first began his run from Saul, he ran and went to Samuel, the man of God himself, and he went to him for help at Ramah. And we read that in chapter 19. He received help there for a short time, and then he went back to Gibeah to look for Jonathan's help again. His bestie, his best friend. He went to Samuel for help, and he went to his best friend, Jonathan, to seek assistance. These are two godly men. And here now is David seeking help from this priest at this holy place. All to say this. In times of trouble, seeking God and godly men and women for counsel is wise, church. In times of trouble, gathering with the church body here in this place, it's wise. It's a good thing. This is the example that David gives to us. David went to Ahimelech at Nob. Listen, friends, in times of trouble, periods of difficulties, difficult seasons in life, you will either do one of two things. One, in difficult times, you will either drive away from God. You will be driven away from him, the church, godly men and women. Or in difficult times, in difficult seasons in life, you will drive closer to God. You will drive closer to the church. You will drive closer to godly men and women in your lives. Who will you turn to in times of trouble? Friend, maybe you are here this morning because you're going through some difficult situation in life, a difficult circumstance, a difficult season in life. Well, I'm here to tell you that you're in the right place this morning. We as a church, the leaders here at this church, we're here for you. Whether you're a member here or not, this is a place of refuge. Now, you can learn a lot about a person by seeing where they turn to in times of trouble. It says a lot about David and his character, but it doesn't mean that his character is without flaws. Let's reread verse 1 and 2. David went to the priest Ahimelech at Nob. Ahimelech was afraid to meet David, so he said to him, "Why are you alone and no one is with you?" David answered the priest Ahimelech, "The king gave me a mission, but he told me, don't let anyone know anything about the mission I'm sending you on or what I've ordered you to do. I've stationed my men at a certain place." Observation number 2 for us this morning: fear can lead us to sin. There's a lot of fear going on. People are afraid. Saul's afraid of David. David is afraid of Saul. Michal was afraid of both her husband, David, and Saul, dad. Jonathan, I'm sure, was afraid as well, afraid of his dad after his own dad tried to kill him, and now he wants to kill his best friend. And here we read that Ahimelech is afraid. Ahimelech is afraid because I'm sure he knows what's going on. He may not have all the details or the facts, but something is off. He senses something is not right. Matter of fact, in the following chapter, he even admits to this in 1 Samuel 22. But we do know that Saul made his feelings public. Remember, I'm wanting to kill David. And so I'm sure this news spread fast all throughout the land. And when the king, or when David, future king, shows up alone, it doesn't look good. Which is why Ahimelech is probably afraid. But I don't want to talk about Ahimelech's fear here. I want to observe someone else's fear. I want to observe David's fear here. Listen, fear motivates many things that we do. And if we're not careful, fear can lead us to sin. And our second observation for this morning, David lies. David lies. Now, if you've been here with us studying 1 Samuel, we know, church, that we've been all over Saul's case, King Saul's, right? And his lack of godly character. And meanwhile, we read of David. David is this hero, a man after God's own heart, and he is. He absolutely is. But now we begin to see some character flaws in David. Astonishing, right? I know. Surprising, though? No. Why? Because he's still a flawed man. Just like Adam. Just like Abraham. Just like Lot. Just like Moses. And I can go on and on and on. David lies to this priest. He goes to the holy place and lies to this priest in this holy place. He deceives Ahimelech by implying that he was on some special covert mission for King Saul. The guy's on the run, he needs help, he needs food and supplies, and so he lies to this priest. And he probably does so because he's unsure if he can even trust this priest. So he lies about it. And you know, in case all of you missed it, but back in chapter 20, David asked Jonathan to lie for him there. He tells Jonathan, if your father misses me at all, say, David urgently requested my permission to go quickly to his hometown, Bethlehem, for an annual sacrifice there involving the whole clan. That was found in 1 Samuel chapter 20, verse 6. But in regards to fear, I want us to listen to these words of the prophet Isaiah as he condemns pagan worship and how fear can cause us to forget the Lord. He says this in Isaiah 57, verse 11. You guys can notate it. Who was it you dreaded and feared so that you lied and didn't remember me or take it to heart? Fear can lead us to forget about God and lie. How many of us have ever been in a situation like David? Maybe not facing death. But out of fear, we end up lying. Clearly, lying is a sin. Not trusting in God is a sin. I'm guilty. Sin has consequences. Later, in just a few chapters, because of David's lie, it will lead to the death of 85 priests, including Ahimelech. A small, harmful lie led to tragedy. Later, David will use lies to cover up some egregious sins of his own. David's lying will not stop. Later in this chapter, we will learn that he even lies about his mental state, and he acts insane and he acts crazy. He acts in ways that people of God should not act. these small, big character flaws we're starting to see in David. Let's reread verse 2. Let's go all the way down to verse 6. David answered the priest Ahimelech, "The king gave me a mission, but he told me, 'Don't let anyone know anything about the mission I'm sending you on or what I've ordered you to do. I've stationed my young men at a certain place. Now, what do you have on hand? Give me 5 loaves of bread or whatever can be found.' The priest told him, 'There is no ordinary bread on hand. However, there is consecrated bread, but the young men may eat it only if they have kept themselves from women.'" Verse 5, David answered him, "I swear that women are being kept from us. As always, when I go out to battle, the young men's bodies are consecrated even on an ordinary mission. So, of course, their bodies are consecrated today." So the priest gave him the consecrated bread, for there was no bread there except the bread of the presence that had been removed from the presence of the Lord. When the bread was removed, it had been replaced with warm bread. And we'll stop right there. Observation number 3 for us this morning: the Lord desires mercy. We're going to spend some time on this observation. There's a lot to cover. And so be prepared to flip through your Bibles. But the crux of this morning's message lies in these verses here. The guy is hungry, so he asks for bread for himself and his men. Now, there's a small problem. Ahimelech didn't have any ordinary bread there in verse 4. Ordinary bread or common bread was bread that can be offered to non-Levites without any special consideration. But there was only special bread, the bread of the presence. In the tabernacle, you had the table of showbread, which was positioned on the right-hand side in the tabernacle, in the first room there. Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 24. Deuteronomy chapter 24. We're going to read a little bit of insights and details on this bread here. Deuteronomy chapter 24, beginning of the Bible. Deuteronomy chapter 24. I want to read verses 5 through 9. And I want you to keep a tab there in Deuteronomy 24 because we're going to come back to it, or a chapter before at least. I told you guys we're going to be flipping through the scriptures here. Deuteronomy 24, beginning in verse 5, it says this. These are instructions for the bread. "Take fine flour and bake it into 12 loaves. Each loaf is to be made with 4 quarts. Arrange them in 2 rows, 6 to a row, on the pure gold table before the Lord." Now, really quickly, 4 quarts, that's a lot. These loaves of bread were huge. Big loaves of bread that we're talking about here. Verse 7, "Place pure frankincense near each row so that it may serve as a memorial portion for the bread and a food offering to the Lord." Verse 8, "The bread is to be set out before the Lord every Sabbath day as a permanent covenant obligation on the part of the Israelites. It belongs to Aaron and his sons who are to eat it in a holy place, for it is the holiest portion for him from the food offerings to the Lord. This is a permanent rule." As part of the Sabbath observance on Friday evening, the priests were to bake these warm loaves of bread before the Lord. The bread was accompanied by frankincense, all placed on this table of showbread there in the tabernacle. On the following Sabbath, fresh bread was offered and the old bread was removed for distribution to the priest. The gift of the bread as provision for the priest is significant because it makes a direct statement that God was not expected to eat the bread, but rather the bread was symbolic of God's provision for Israel. God provides, and he provided for Israel and reminds them of the mutual covenant between them. This is the bread that Ahimelech gave to David, but they were only to eat of it if they were clean, if they were set apart, consecrated. According to Leviticus chapter 15, men or women who had engaged in in sexual relations had to take a ritual bath and were considered unclean until the following evening. It was customary for soldiers to practice ritual purity when preparing for battle. And David assured to Ahimelech, the priest, that this was the case, that his soldiers had refrained from touching any woman. And also, while active on duty, David and his men are clean, even on everyday, ordinary missions, David says. Now, question to all of you, church, is this. After reading Deuteronomy 24, who was the bread for again? Someone say it loud. The priest, Aaron and his sons, right? Tribe of Levi. David is from what tribe? Judah. Is he allowed then, technically speaking, to eat the bread according to Deuteronomy chapter 24? No, he's not. Then why was he able to? Keep this thought in mind. Why was David able to eat of this bread? And to help us answer this question, turn with me now to the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew's Gospel. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. We're going deeper here. Welcome to Temple Baptist Church. We flip through the scriptures. Matthew chapter 12. We're going to read verses 1 through 8. Jesus refers to this very scene here in 1 Samuel chapter 21. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8, it says this. At that time, Jesus passed through the grain fields on the Sabbath. His disciples were hungry and began to pick and eat some heads of grain. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to him, "See, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath." He said to them, "Haven't you read what David did when he and those who were with him were hungry? How he entered the house of God and they ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for him or for those with him to eat, but only for the priest? Or haven't you read in the law that on the Sabbath days the priests in the temple violate the Sabbath and are innocent? I tell you, something greater than the temple is here. If you had known what this means, 'I desire mercy and not sacrifice,' you would not have condemned the innocent, for the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath." Let's look at how this incident with Jesus' disciples relate to 1 Samuel 21. The Pharisees are trying to trap Jesus by insisting that Jesus' disciples were breaking the law. Now, what law were they referring to? Go back to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 23. I told you, save your spots. Deuteronomy chapter 23. This is important. We're going to be piecing some truths here together. Your disciples are breaking the law. What law? Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 25. It says this. When you enter your neighbor's standing grain, you may pluck heads of grain with your hand, but do not put a sickle to your neighbor's grain. Now then, according to Deuteronomy chapter 23, was it lawful or wrong for the disciples to be plucking grains on this Sabbath then? No, right? I mean, according to Deuteronomy 23, they're allowed to. You may pluck heads of the grain with your hand. Just don't put a sickle to your neighbor's grain. Don't take it a step further. Don't actually start to do labor and swing that thing around. So no, they did not break any law. The Pharisees, matter of fact, they didn't even know the law themselves. And here they are accusing them. They were wrong in their accusation in which really says a lot about their attitude. Jesus then points to our account in 1 Samuel 21, where it actually was wrong to eat of the bread of the presence, because in Deuteronomy 24, we are told it was only reserved for the priests. Not only that, but the priests would violate the law by working themselves on the Sabbath and were considered innocent. And what Jesus was illustrating to us, church, between both accounts is this. First thing, Jesus, who is the greater priest, can get away with, first of all, working on the Sabbath, just like the priest of old. But the Pharisees didn't see Jesus as this high priest because of their spiritual blindness. In Matthew 12, verse 6, I tell you that something greater than the temple is here. He was referring to himself. But the second thing that I want to point out is the Lord desires mercy over sacrifice. Ahimelech was bending the rules. Since only priests were allowed to eat the bread and only in the holy place, however, Jesus endorsed Ahimelech's judgment in putting mercy before ceremonial law. In Matthew 12, verse 7, if you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice. Jesus wanted to point out the hypocrisy of the Pharisees. The Pharisees were tripping on Jesus' disciples for eating the heads of grain, which was permissible, and then comparing it to our situation here in 1 Samuel 21, where it wasn't permissible for David and his men to eat the bread, but was allowed. And if David and his men were allowed to eat of the bread of presence, how much more were Jesus and his disciples able to eat the heads of grain, which was allowed? Now, friends, this is profound on so many levels. The exception made for David as God's anointed prefigures the role of Jesus Christ, God's anointed, in relation to the law. David, to the Pharisees, was seen as this hero, a grand figure to them. Oh, that's David. David's the man. David was God's anointed. And there was an exception made for David. And though David is not a priest formally, David is described with priest-like qualities. He's considered a man after God's own heart. He will go on and represent God to the people and then the people of Israel to God. And so he's able to eat this bread. Jesus, though, who is the son of David, the son of the living God himself, is God's anointed and the better David, the better king, the better priest, and yet the Pharisees didn't treat him as such. I tell you something greater than the temple is here. If you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice. Ahimelech put David's need and life ahead of religious ceremony and fed him holy food, which upheld the greater law of love. In Leviticus 19, now, the term for priest here in our passage is Kohen. You guys have learned this in the past. And a priest represents God to the people, and they represent the people to God. They are mediators. They act as mediators, one can say. They act as a bridgeway between God and people. And Ahimelech was doing just that, even if it costed him his own life, and it later did. And church, this is the point in all of this. Legalism is destructive. Legalism can limit our love or even negate the law of love, of loving God and loving our neighbor as we should. But to do good and to save life is God's greater law. And sometimes we as Christians need to be reminded of the dangers of legalistic rituals and legalistic attitudes. We need to be a people, a church who desires to be merciful, to show compassion, generosity. We need to represent God to the people. We need to represent God to the city of Paris, at our work, in the school place. We need to represent God to the people and represent the people to God. Or in other words, we need to be Christ to them and bring them to Christ, because we too, church, hear me out, we too are priests. We are a royal priesthood. And we must be a blessing to people in the same way, not only spiritually, but physically, meeting needs of people, whether they are members of this church or not, whether they are poor or wealthy, whether they are young or old. The Lord desires mercy over sacrifice, mercy over worship. Are you being legalistic, friend? Do you have a legalistic mindset or attitude? Can't believe that person sitting next to me here in this church, in this place. This person's evil, wicked. Hey, well, I'm glad that at least that person is here in this place. Jonathan has ripped jeans. How dare he? I'm sorry. I guess I can get away with it because I'm the youth pastor. But we can have legalistic attitudes and mindsets. No, but Jonathan, seriously, your pants are ripped. Tell those to the kids and the people who gather in Cambodia on a Sunday morning or their day of worship with raggedy ripped clothes. The Lord desires mercy, church. Are you living out your role as a priest? Are you representing Him, the Father? And this is why I love the Old Testament, and this is why the Old Testament is so important. Anyone who says the Old Testament is not necessary, punch him in the throat. I'm kidding. Mercy. We got to be merciful. That was a test. Let's continue reading. Verse 7. One of Saul's servants detained. Oh, go back to 1 Samuel. I'm sorry. Go back to 1 Samuel 21. You guys are probably like, where are we? 1 Samuel 21, verse 7. One of Saul's servants detained before the Lord was there that day. His name was Doeg the Edomite, chief of Saul's shepherds. Observation number 4. The sly enemy. Remember this name, Doeg. He will come up again later in a couple weeks. We are told in our text that Doeg was detained before the Lord. How or why, the text doesn't tell us. But we're also told that Doeg is an Edomite. Now, if you guys know Bible, Edomites were enemies of God. They were enemies of Israel. They battled it out on many occasions. The Edomites are descendants of Esau. The Edomites are the ones that refused the Israelites safe passage in the days of Moses and Numbers. They were an unkind people group. They were comparable to the Amalekites. And you guys know what happened to them in 1 Samuel 15. But even this detail, it's something that's noteworthy. You see the parallels from Israel's wilderness and the enemies that they encountered. The Edomites were enemies. They were enemies of God. And we have the same enemies here, or in our case, an enemy, singular, who just happens to be an Edomite. And what's even more disturbing about this guy is that this was an enemy, and he was a servant of Saul. That's weird. Why would you have that? I mean, I know it was common to take your captives and use them as slaves, but he had this enemy in his courts. Or there, as we will soon see in a couple weeks. But Doeg, I don't want to get ahead of myself. Doeg, I don't know. This guy is a cold-blooded killer, evil and wicked. He would just add more drama to our story. This guy is watching David here. He sees all that's going on. He sees Ahimelech meeting with David and providing David this bread. He sees and he knows what's going on. And this guy, again, would be the guy responsible for slaying and dropping 85 priests. 85. You never have enough bad guys in a story, right? That's a mental note, the sly enemy. I don't want to spend too much time on this guy because, again, in a couple weeks, we'll go in further with him. But let's close out these last verses, verse 8 and 9. David said to Ahimelech, "Do you have a spear or sword on hand? I didn't even bring my sword or my weapon since the king's mission was urgent." The priest replied, "The sword of Goliath, the Philistine, whom you killed in the valley of Elah is here, wrapped in a cloth behind the ephod. If you want, take it for yourself. Then take it, for there isn't another one here." "There's none like it," David said. "Give it to me." The last observation for us this morning, observation number 5, weapon of destruction. Now, Goliath's sword was an enormous weapon, I'm sure very heavy. I mean, if Goliath's spear weighed 600 shekels, which is about 15 pounds, his sword must have been very similar in weight, if not more. And just by contrast, a normal long sword usually weighs between 2.5 to 4.5 pounds at the very most, which is why David said, "Hey, give it to me, there's none like it." He surely knew that that was the case. This was the very same sword that David used to cut off Goliath's head in 1 Samuel 17. And then 1 Samuel 17, we're also told that David took Goliath's weapons, spear and sword, back to his own tent. And now, the Bible mentions to us that his sword is here. Why is this weapon here in the tabernacle? Interesting. I don't know, and I wish I did. But David knows, though. Perhaps he already knew it was there, which is why he went to Ahimelech to begin with. He knows that there's food there. He knows that there's Goliath's sword. The guy's on the run. He left quickly, and he felt the need to have some sort of weapon. I mean, David asked for a spear or sword in verse 8, but this request is strange on David's behalf. It's strange, being how he felt about Goliath's spear and his sword back in 1 Samuel 17. When facing Goliath, listen to David's words, verses 45 and 46. In regards to Goliath's weapons, he said this in verse 45. David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head." Last I remember, he mocked Goliath's weapons. So why does he want Goliath's sword? I mean, later David will go into battle against the Philistines again, so he does need some kind of weapon, but I'm pretty sure he can grab a weapon from one of his men who had some, I'm sure. But why this sword? And why is he excited to see it? Well, here's my honest answer as to why I think he requested this item or was excited to see it. I think in our moments of fear, in our moments of weaknesses, church, even moments of terror, we can be quick to react in the flesh and act unwise. David, I believe, is acting out of his fear. David doesn't need the sword. He doesn't need even Goliath's sword to defend himself. And I say this for a few reasons. But back in chapter 17, David understood this. "But I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands." Was Goliath's sword going to protect David or deliver David from Saul? Nope. It was the Lord. Later in chapter 24, in chapter 24 of this scroll, a key scene. 1 Samuel 24, David, he spares Saul's life. He had the opportunity to kill Saul himself, even if he had Goliath's sword on him. But he didn't. He didn't. He wasn't going to kill Saul with the sword. As a matter of fact, listen to his words. I'm going to read a few of his words in chapter 24, verse 13. These are David's words. As the old saying goes, from evildoers come evil deeds. So my hand will not touch you. If anything, I truly believe that Goliath's sword in the temple was a tangible reminder and evidence of God's help in a time of great need. David, in the middle of his fear, needed to be reminded that God was his stronghold, that God will deliver him. He overcame Goliath with the Lord's help, a man much stronger, a man much fiercer than Saul. And as one commentator said this about this, he said this, self-assurance and self-sufficiency will ultimately lead to self-defeat, but steadfast trust in Almighty God and the acknowledgement that apart from Him we are powerless will lead us to ultimate victory. I mean, if I would have saw Goliath's sword there, I would have been like, oh, the Lord's with me. He was there with me when I slayed that giant. He is with me now. Now, some of you might disagree with my interpretation on this matter with Goliath's sword, and it's okay. Different commentators, different theologians said different things. It leads to a great discussion. Oh, why did David take that sword? Oh, is he excited to see it? But I would encourage you to read Psalm 34 this week, church. Write this down in your Bible in a note, Psalm 34. Psalm 34 is going to be a very key passage to give us some more insights, even on our scene here, but then also next week, when David heads to Gath. Psalm 34 is a very key passage, very popular passage. Read it this week, study it. And as you read and as you study it this week, again, it gives us passage in our insight for our passage this morning. But after you read Psalm 34, you come to the conclusion, you could let me know, who did David trust in? Was it in the sword? Or was it in Yahweh? In closing, I want for us to leave with a few takeaways this morning before we part together and before we take communion this morning. The first takeaway I want for all of us to know and understand is, where and whom do you turn to in times of trouble? It does say a lot about you, church. Do you turn to Christ? Do you turn to the Lord? Do you seek the church in times of need as you should? As we read, David ended up going to a priest for help, and help was given. Secondly, fear can be crippling. It can bring about anxieties, unwanted stresses. It can lead us to do irrational things. It can lead us to even sin against the Lord. David lies, as we read in our passage. But we need to constantly bring our fears to the Lord and keep those fears in check, identify them, and maybe even, if we have to, repent of them. Thirdly, the Lord desires mercy over sacrifice. We must never let legalism come in the way of loving God and loving others. And lastly, fourthly, we can never depend on our own strength and self-sufficiency. Our strength comes from the Lord. And sometimes when life gets crazy, we can forget that. We can forget that God is our strength, our refuge, help in times of trouble. David was excited for Goliath's sword, but it's the Lord Almighty who breaks the bows of warriors, and we must depend and rely on Him. David, the fugitive, had encountered yet another person in our story, drama story who helped him in his hour of need. There was Jonathan, there was Michal, there was Samuel, and now we have Ahimelech. Now, I've learned a lot about Ahimelech these last several days this week, and I can honestly say, man, Ahimelech is my guy too. In just a few chapters, we get to learn more about this guy and how he stands up to Saul. And then we will read about what ends up happening to him. But Ahimelech was a righteous dude. Meanwhile, there were others who were against David. Saul and Doeg, the Pharisees, were hostile to Jesus. They too were like Saul. As a matter of fact, they even acted like Doeg, spying and keeping their eyes on Jesus from a distance. And I want to end with this final thought for us this morning. There was a theologian, pastor by the name of Kent Hughes, who said this in regard to this section of Scripture, and I thought it was very fitting. He says this, God's king is still despised and opposed today. He is still less than impressive to many. Will you join the ranks of Saul, Doeg, and the Pharisees, or the body of those who serve the king, whatever the cost? Friends, whose side are you on? Maybe you are walking against, not with the Lord. And friend, if that's you this morning, you can. You believe on Jesus, repent of your sin. Come to the one who can help you. He'll forgive you of your sin. And you can join him and team up with him on his side. Just like Jonathan, just like Michal, just like Samuel. There are consequences if you don't. There are consequences if you don't. And for all of us this morning, I pray that these observations would just be reminders, simple reminders for us as a church, as we continue to walk with him all the days of our life. We know life can be crazy at times. But yes, we must and have to turn to the Lord, turn to the church, to be encouraged, to be strengthened. Amen? Let's pray.